of good fish, good eating.
This is Bill Frank. He's 91 years old. He remembers how it used to be.
And we mostly lived on dried fish and fresh fish and all different kinds of fish, you know, that they come up the river. This river, Nisqually River, we lived up there about 5 miles from here, the mouth of Muck Creek. There must have been a village there. There were three of these long houses there, three smokehouses. When I come to, you know, and I come into real life things.
This is the Nisqually Indian Reservation, created under the provisions of the Medicine Creek Treaty of 1854. Like most reservation land, it was later allotted to individual Indian families. When Bill Frank was born in 1879, his family lived on their allotment of 205 acres.
Now, Dad, when you was living back over here on your property across the river, was there a lot more fish, Dad, at that time than there is today?
Oh, yes. The river was just full of fish. All these creeks were full of fish. Yellow Creek, Muck Creek. Yeah. Several other creeks on up to the toward the La Grande.
During World War I, the Army condemned the reservation land on the east side of the river for Fort Lewis. All the families on that side of the river were removed from their homes, and the government decided what compensation they were going to receive. Bill Franks received 6 acres, several miles downstream from the reservation, and it is still held for him in federal trust like allotted reservation land. This is the place still known today as Frank's Landing. Bill Frank lives here. His wife, Angeline, lives with him. His son, Bill Jr., lives here too, with his wife, Norma, their two children, Sugar and Maureen. Bill Frank Jr. and his family live in this house. And in this house, Liz Maysell, Grandpa's daughter, with her husband, Al Bridges. Elle and Maysell have 3 daughters, the youngest, Allison, and Valerie. Their oldest daughter, Suzette, lives here with her husband, Sid Mills, and the baby, Powton. And then there's Herman Johns, better known as Curly, another of Bill Frank's grandchildren. This is the family that lives at Frank's Landing. During the summer, they work at various jobs, frequently in neighboring berry fields and tree farms. But when autumn comes and the salmon start running, Bill Frank's family, like all their ancestors, set their nets for fish. They smoke some for themselves and they sell some, even as their ancestors.
There's no court to tell that you have jurisdiction on this property.
We are under arrest. This is illegal. We're going to have to see
the sister.
Hey, Sydney, you're under arrest.
My father and Sid were arrested off the landing here. So the following day, to let him know that we weren't going to quit fishing, Allison and I, my younger sister, set a net up there at the trestle, about a mile and a half from here, upriver.
In 1854, Territorial Governor Isaac Stevens made treaties with all the Indians in Washington. The Indians gave up all claims to the land and the territory except for special areas reserved to them. In return, they were to receive payments and were promised that they and their descendants would always have the right to fish in their usual and accustomed grounds. Valerie Bridges grew up learning how to fish here on the Nisqually, where her grandfather fished.
Valerie, you heard when your grandfather told of a white man who came with promises of gold, saying, sell us the land that lies under the sun. You'll live free as long as the rivers run, as long as the rivers run.
we set the net and waited for the state. We're just going to let them know that we're not going to quit fishing. We have this fishing right. It's a treaty, supreme law of the land under their constitution, and we're not going to give up our fishing rights. There are treaties throughout the United States being broken. That's really what it is, a treaty we're fighting for. Treaties throughout the United States. We resisted when they did try to take our net because it is our property, and not only protecting our property, but ourselves, because we too have been clubbed. Night raids, tear gas, and we're getting sick and tired of it.
He promised us gold, he promised us grain, he promised us houses safe from the rain. He said that his words could not be undone, but would last for as long as the rivers run, as long as the rivers run.
They patrol the river now at night, 12 o'clock at night. The boat runs up and down the river to see if there's any nets in the river.
Did they watch our friends that come into Frank's Landing? They're watching us with binoculars from across the river.
They said that old and no good for nothing now. We have no more treaty.
The state could come and take my boat, motor, and all my fish, and myself, and haul us all to jail. It's been 4 years now since some of my gear has been confiscated, and I haven't got it back yet.
Oh, well, they're really taking everything we've had. So it looks like we just have to quit fishing. If we want to eat fish, we buy fish off of the white man, yeah.
We staged fishing down here at Frank's Landing. This was a demonstration to put the problem before the public.
We said that we were going to demonstrate this right by going out and going fishing, which we feel is a passive way of resisting this force used against us. The state came down in a large force of about 50 game and fisheries wardens to put down a group of 8 adults and about 30 children, ranging from 2 years old on up to 17. And they just took over the Indian scene, you might say.
We decided we would put our boats on the opposite side of the river to minimize mingling with the huge crowd of Indians and newspaper people that was there, and when we went across the river, they started throwing clubs, and so we had to bring in our full force and arrest anyone who had resisted or interfered with us in the performance of our duty.
I was on the jury of the case when the state of Washington was versing the Nisqually Indian. Well, they testified that to their belief, weapons carried.
There was no weapons in any of them that made an arrest there.
And still, these pictures proved the fact that some of the game department officials that got on the stand and testified had weapons in their possession and used them.
They have billy clubs. They have billy clubs made out of lead pipe.
The only people that was hurt was our own people. There was no Indian people hurt at all.
I came upon one game warden, and he had my two nieces by the hair, and he was pounding one of their faces into a log and you know, just shaking the other girl. She was scratching him to try and get free, and I went over and grabbed him to try and make him turn. The kids lose. I said, they're just kids.
I think the state's behavior here, the state of Washington, towards the Indian people has been shabby. Much of it has been brutal. It wouldn't stand the light of day. Usually denied. The state takes a very pious posture and talks about conservation whenever its Indian policies are brought into question. And so in this context, it is significant and very exciting, to me at least, that the state was exposed in this instance.
The fight goes on. The Indians won that case. But now Al Bridges and his family are on their way to court, charged yet again with illegal fishing. In the state capitol, they will wear, as they always do, traditional dress.
Can you remember the time that you have held your head high and told all your friends of your Indian claim? Proud, good lady, and proud, good man, your great-great-grandfather from Indian blood sprang. And you feel in your heart for these ones. Oh, it's written in books and in songs.
To dramatize the fishing rites, the Frank Landing encampment moved into Olympia and set a net at the mouth of the dam where there is a fish ladder. The fishery officers and police responded, giving the public a chance to see the kind of action that usually takes place under the cover of night on the Nisqually River.
Come gather round me and I'll sing you a song. I'll tell you a story of people that were strong. We live with nature in harmony. Obeying the laws that were taught to me. Greeting a stranger with an open hand. Sheltered and fed him and called him friend. Once I was wild as the eagle in the sky, free to love and to live and to die. I roam this land from the mountains to the sea. Brother to the elk, the bear and the deer. Up the river, the lakes and the redwood tree. This was my land as far as I could see. I had no jails nor prison farm. No barbed wire to do me harm. I paid no one to rule over me. No one owned the shade of the tree.
Of the people who came to help in 68, only one stayed. Sid Mills, a Yakima Indian stationed at Fort Lewis, announced he would not go back to the Army. Instead, he remained at Frank's Landing and married Suzette. A year later, dozens of cases were still in court. The survival of American Indian Association was broke. So once again, the family at Frank's Landing was alone on the Nisqually River. The day came that Al, Sid, Valerie, and Allison were all in jail. Suzette had just had a baby, Houghton. So Maysel Bridges and Norma Frank were left to fish by themselves.
Going to be taken.
You must take us with it, but we're not letting go of fishing under Military Reservation. And we're both involved members. We are too.
You're poaching, what you're doing.
No, we're not either. You're the one that's poaching. You're the one that's encroaching on our land.
Put that in.
This is the last net you got.
Both under arrest and facing home bar.